pretty work in practice.
3%. Now, what's the next one of these things I can do in my head?
To test theories of probability, Kay established his own public opinion polling business, which he runs from his home. His wife, Gary, is the other half of Kay Associates.
No, this is my stuff.
We have been in the public opinion polling business for about 10 years here in El Paso. We kind of work as a team together.
Okay.
What a public opinion poll will do is actually quantify how it is that a particular body of people feel about a particular issue at a particular time.
A public opinion poll can enable Kay to understand what the more than 500,000 residents of El Paso are thinking. Amazingly, he can gain this insight by just gathering the opinions of a small group. According to the laws of probability, a small representative group will accurately reflect the opinions of a larger society if the participants are chosen at random.
How many of these do I have to do?
Selecting the respondents, the potential respondents, in a scientific survey is very much like trying to get a representative sample from a large container of minestrone soup.
It smells good.
First thing I want to do, and this is where the randomization comes in, just as it does in a scientific public opinion poll, you want to make sure that the pot is thoroughly stirred. Okay, we stir it, reach in, and pull it out. This gives me a pretty good indication of what the ingredients are in the minestrone. I look at it, I see I've got sausage, I've got carrots in here, I've got green beans, I've got kidney beans, and I've got some onions in here and also some celery. So by thoroughly stirring the pot, I was able to get a representative sample of what the soup ingredients are. Just to illustrate the importance of the mixing, what I'm going to do is now reach in and just pull out a sample from the top, and I'll see how representative that is of the soup ingredients. Well, the scoop size is still the same. I've got the same size sample, but I don't have a thorough mix, so I don't end up with a representative sample.
When pollsters scoop out participants, it is essential that they start with sample groups that are truly representative. If the group is not representative, no amount of mixing and scooping will help. The poll will be misleading. For example, one of the biggest blunders in polling involved one of the largest polls in history. In 1936, the Literary Digest magazine polled 10 million people and predicted that Republican Alf Landon was going to be the next president of the United States. The fact that you might not recognize Alf Landon's name is a good indicator that the poll was dead wrong. The problem with the Digest poll arose from the techniques used to create their sample group. For starters, the Digest relied on various lists, and the lists were not representative of the population. For example, lists derived from the phone book left out people who didn't have phones. This was a large part of the population in 1936. Membership lists from country clubs excluded poor participants. That same year, another pollster, George Gallup, was getting his start. Gallup chose lists that truly represented the population. To ensure an accurate mix, he then chose 50,000 people at random, which is less than 1% of the size of the Literary Digest sample. Because Gallup relied on sound sampling techniques, his results were more accurate. Gallup predicted that Roosevelt would be victorious by a landslide. And the rest is history. For both men. Polling is a critical element these days for every election. And before the mayoral election in El Paso, Bill Kay performs a series of public opinion polls. To establish the sample for his poll, Kay begins with a list that reflects El Paso's diverse population. This is like his large pot of minestrone soup. Next, he uses his computer to randomly scoop a group from the list.
A lot of people have a difficult time in conceiving that it's possible by taking a relatively small sample on the order of hundreds, you can actually make a generalization about a population, say, of perhaps even millions. It's always very interesting to me. I really get a kick out of finally when this is all the effort's been done, I can actually tabulate the numbers and see what the poll showed.
By relying on good polling techniques, Kay is able to predict the outcome of the El Paso mayoral election. And to the surprise of some, what was perceived as a horse race turns out to be a landslide.
Okay, this is hot off the computer, all 309 respondents.
Live from the news station. This is News 7 at 6.
Now here's a look at the actual numbers from the El Paso Times News 7 poll that led Carlos Ramirez to his decision.
Dr. Fink at 7%. Carlos Ramirez, 14%. Mayor Francis, 71% of the people are going to vote for him.
Larry Francis is their choice for mayor.
So call up his honor very quickly and be nice to him.
While probability is critical for creating an accurate random sample, one of its greatest powers is that it helps us to assess the value of results. And this power, as you'll see, is helping in the battle against disease. Over $14 billion is spent yearly in the United States on medical research, and often the results are dramatic.
For the first time, researchers are saying they have evidence that AZT can actually prevent the spread of AIDS.
In the search for new drugs, we turn to probability. Probability helps us to determine the safety and effectiveness of new medicines.
Scientists say the new test should be a great help in finding better treatments or a cure.
Susan Ellenberg is a division director at the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. Her department designs and evaluates studies of new vaccines. She remembers what was possibly the most famous application of statistics to fight disease, the polio vaccine trials of the 1950s.
And the numbers, but I'm not sure that I did it right.
Anybody who was around back then will remember there was enormous concern. Everyone was very fearful about polio. People wouldn't let their kids go swimming. It was one of the most fearful diseases.
Between 1916 and the 1950s, something mysterious and terrible was happening to America's children. Without warning,